Hello friends, today we will start the unit number 5, that is runtime environment. These are the contents which we are going to see during this presentation: storage organization, stack allocation of space. Then it is categorized into two types: activation tree, activation record, parameter passing methods, and symbol table organization or symbol table generations. So these are the contents which we are going to see. Let us start with the first point, that is storage organization. Now before we can see what is storage organization, we should know why should we go for this storage organization, or what is the role of compiler here in the storage organization. See, we are writing a program. After writing a program, we save the program to somewhere. Let us suppose I have written one program and I want to store that program. Normally that program is stored on some drive. Let us suppose I have stored one program on E drive. So the area where program is stored, that area is called as a logical address space. Logical address space means what? The address or the area where the program is permanently stored. Now many a time we write a program and we store program on some drive. So there the program is permanently stored, but while execution of the program, that program needs to be taken into the physical memory. Physical memory means what? The RAM. RAM is called as a physical memory. The entire execution is taken place only into the RAM. Okay, so though we have stored our program on logical address space, but that program needs to be executed into the physical address space. So how it is done? Now just now I told you that my program is stored on E drive. So here the operating system comes into existence. So operating system will take my program which is there in the E drive and store that program into the, or take that program into the physical memory. That is what I can say, the operating system maps the logical address space into the physical address space. Okay, now what is role of compiler here? The compiler occupies block of memory into the RAM or physical memory, and that block of memory is called as a runtime memory or runtime environment. Okay, so what is runtime environment? The block of memory which compiler allocates into the physical memory or RAM. Okay, so that is nothing but the runtime memory. And here it is shown in the diagram, typical subdivision of runtime memory. So the runtime memory is categorized into these different points, or these different blocks are there into the runtime memory. So compiler deals with logical address space. As just now we discussed, that logical address space is the permanent memory area where the program is stored. OS maps the logical address space into the physical address space. That is, OS takes that program which is there in the logical address space into the physical address space, and compiler allocates this block of memory. It is divided into different parts: code area, static area, heap area, free memory, and stack. Now what is there in the code area? Code area is the low end of the memory. So size of the program is known at the compile time itself. We write a program and size of the program is known at the compile time. So that code or that size is allocated into the code area. That is, in another word, we can say the code or the program is taken into this code area. Okay, so memory location for code are determined at compile time and usually placed in the low end of the memory. That is, this code is a low end of the memory where the program is stored. Static. So some variables we are using in the program. So size of the variables are known at the compile time itself. Okay, so let it be any number of variables you are using in the program. So size of those variables is known at the compile time itself, and that variables are stored into the static area. So size of the some program data are known at compile time and can be placed in another statically determined area, and it is also in static in nature because its size is known at the compile time itself, so it is a static. Then third one is a heap. Now heap is dynamic in nature. Heap is dynamic in nature means what? Its size can be changed as the program execution starts. So when we start the program execution, size of the heap can be increased or can be decreased. and size of the heap can be increased towards the stack. Okay, so it is dynamic in nature and it may change its size as the program execution proceeds. Then some free memory area is given. So for what purpose this free memory area is given? Because heap as well as stack both are dynamic in nature. So if heap changes its size or heap increased in size as the program execution goes on, then its memory or its size can be allocated from the free memory. So that's why this free memory area is given. Okay, stack is also one of the dynamic in nature, dynamic data structure we can say. Okay, the basic purpose of stack is to store the activation record of a program or procedure. What is that activation record? That we are going to see further. But stack is dynamic in nature, and stack means what? Stack size of the stack also can be changed at the runtime. Okay, means stack can be increased in size or stack can be decreased in size as the program execution proceeds, and stack increase its size towards the heap area. So that's why this arrow is shown. Upward arrow is shown for stack, and for heap downward arrow is shown. That indicates what? Heap size is increased towards the stack and stack size is increased towards the heap. Okay, then stack allocation of space. Now before that we should know the purpose of stack. Why for we use the stack, or what is the purpose behind using the stack? So stack allocation of the process. Just now I told you that the purpose of stack is to store the activation record of a process. What is mean by activation record, or when can we say the procedure is active? So when procedure starts its execution, then the procedure becomes active procedure. Okay, and one of the record of that process is created. One of the record of that procedure is created, and that record is nothing but the activation record. So the activation record provides the information to the operating system about the status of the procedure. That is, how many parameters that the current active procedure is using. Then what is the return value of the procedure? Then so different types of parameters are there in the activation record that we are going to see further. This additional information, or this information, is provided to the operating system. Okay, who provides this information? The activation record. So whenever procedure is in its active states, that is whenever procedure is in activation, its activation record is created, and that activation record is placed onto the stack. Okay, so now the activation or execution of the procedure is taken place in a two ways. That is, first is a nested execution or non-overlapping execution. Now what is non-overlapping and nested execution? Non-overlapping execution means what? Let us suppose we have two procedures A and B. Okay, then procedure A starts its execution before procedure B. Procedure A finishes its execution before procedure B. Means what? Procedure A is executed separately. After complete execution of procedure A, procedure B starts its execution and finishes it. So this is what? Non-overlapping execution of the procedures. Means what? There is no overlapping. Procedure A executes separately, procedure B executes separately. So this is what the non-overlapping execution. Now what is nested execution? Nested execution means what? Suppose we have two procedures, procedure A and procedure B. Now procedure A is in active state, that is procedure A starts its execution. Before procedure A finishes its execution, procedure B becomes active. Okay, means what? Procedure B starts its activation in procedure A only. So this is what nested execution of the procedure means. What? Before A finishes its execution, procedure B starts its execution. So this is what nested execution of the procedure. Okay, so here it is given procedure activation. Each execution of procedure is called as activation of the procedure. An execution of procedure P starts at the beginning of the procedure body. Means what? Procedure, if I say P is a procedure, then when P executes its first statement, I can say that procedure P is in its active state. or procedure P has started its execution. When procedure P is completed, it return control to the point immediately after a place where P was called. Means what? When procedure P finishes its execution, it goes back to previous point where the procedure P has started, and there afterward the further program starts its execution. Okay. Then call graph. Call graph is what? It is a directed graph which shows the call of a procedure, means how the procedures are called, that is shown by the call graph. So it is a directed multigraph where the nodes are the procedure of the program. In the call graph, we have a nodes that indicates the procedure which are written into the program, and the edges represents calls between these procedure. Okay. So in the node represents what? The procedures, and the edges between the nodes represents the call between the procedure. Okay. Here one example we have taken, call graph. Okay. So this is the example. Here we have written one program. Right side of the diagram indicates execution of the procedure and call of the procedure. So main, read array, quick sort and partition, these are the nodes of the call graph as shown in the diagram. Main, read array, just see the right hand side of the procedure or right hand side of the diagram, there one graph is drawn. So main, read array, quick sort and partition, these are what? Name of the procedure. And every time, see, listen, main procedure starts its execution first, so that's why main will be first in execution. So from main, quick sort, just see the program, from main the read array function is called, or read array procedure is called. So read array procedure, then after read array procedure, quick sort procedure is called. Now quick sort, this quick sort procedure may be called multiple times, so that's why the 2-3 arrows are shown to the quick sort procedure. Okay. And from quick sort procedure also we call the partition procedure. So directed arrows are shown from main to read array, main to quick sort, and quick sort to partition. That indicates that the call to this particular procedure from the previous procedure. Okay. Activation tree. The activation of the procedure is represented by using a tree called as an activation tree. Okay, we can use a tree to show the way control enters and leaves activation. So activation of the procedure, if we have n number of procedure, we have 5 procedures. So how this procedure starts its execution and how they exit from their activation. So that is shown by the activation tree. Now what is there in the activation tree? Each node represents an activation of the procedure. Root node represents the activation of the main program, because the main program is the procedure which starts its execution first. Okay, so main will be at the root node always. So keep in mind, main program will be at root node. The node A is a parent of the node B if and only if the control flows from A to B. A is left to the node B if and only if lifetime of A occurs before the lifetime of B. It means that node A is nothing but the procedure A. So if procedure A starts its activation before the procedure B, then the procedure A will be added as left node to the tree, and node B will be added as right node to the tree. Okay, so left node indicates that it starts its activation before the right node. So here one example is taken. So always at, just now we have seen, always at root node main program will be there. So first main program will start its activation. In main program, procedure P may starts its activation. In procedure P, before procedure P finishes its activation, procedure Q starts its activation. So procedure Q begin and end Q. End Q indicates that procedure Q finishes its activation. Now after procedure Q finishes its activation, procedure S starts its activation and finishes its activation. And after that, procedure P will finish its activation. Okay. Once again, procedure S will start its activation, and at the end,
main process or main program finishes its activation. So initially main program starts its activation, at the end main program finishes its activation. Okay, and that is shown at the right side of the diagram. It is shown which procedure starts its activation and where it ends its activation. That is shown in the right side of the diagram, as it is a nested execution. So in the diagram it indicates the nested execution. Nested means what? Before a active procedure finishes its activation, new process starts its activation. Okay, so enter main indicates that main procedure or main program started its activation. In main program, enter P, that is procedure P started its activation. In procedure P, procedure Q starts its activation, and exit Q indicates procedure Q finishes its activation. After that, enter S indicates procedure S starts its activation, and exit S procedure S finishes its activation. Then after that, procedure P will finish its activation. Once again, procedure S starts its activation, exit S is a termination of the procedure S, that is finishes its activation, and at the end main finishes its act. Diagram of activation tree, where root node indicates the activation of main program. Then it has a left child and right child. Left child P indicates that procedure P has started its execution before procedure S. In procedure P, there is a nested call. In procedure P, procedure Q starts its activation. When procedure Q finishes its activation, procedure S starts its activation. And when procedure S finishes its activation, at the end procedure P finishes its activation. Once procedure P finishes its activation, then procedure S starts its activation. Okay, this is shown in the activation tree. It shows when procedure starts its activation and when the procedure ends its activation. Now this is one program, simple program. As we know that main program, that is main procedure, starts its activation first. So void main indicates main program. From main program, get function is called or get procedure is called. So in main program we have get procedure starts its activation. Before get procedure finishes its activation, procedure add starts its activation. When procedure add finishes its activation, procedure sub starts its activation in procedure get only. When procedure sub finishes its activation, then procedure get will finish its activation, and at the end main program finishes its activation. So this is shown. The possible activation of given program can be given as, so it is shown like main program starts its activation. In main program, enter get indicates get procedure starts its activation. In get procedure, add procedure starts its activation. Leave add indicates add procedure finishes its activation. Then enter sub indicates that in get procedure itself, sub procedure starts its activation. Leave sub indicates that procedure sub finishes its activation. Then leave get indicates that get procedure finishes its activation, and at the end main program finishes its activation. Okay, so it shows when the procedure starts its activation and when it ends its activation. Now this is shown in the activation tree. So here you can observe main, enter main indicates main program started its activation. So main is at the root. Then after main, get procedure started its activation. So there is a edge from main to get indicates that from main get procedure has started its activation. Okay, then enter get, then add. So in get procedure, here in get procedure, procedure add has started its activation. So in get there is a edge from get to add, that is add is a left child of get, indicates that from get function or add procedure started its activation. Leave add indicates that add procedure finishes its activation. After the procedure add finishes its activation, procedure sub will be active procedure and it finishes its activation,
After that, gate will finish its activation, and at the end, main will finish its activation. So that possible activation is shown in the activation tree, where node indicates the name of procedure and age indicates that the activation of the procedure. So activation of procedure call corresponds to pre-order traversal of activation tree. That is, visit the left child first, then right child, and then gate procedure. That is, left child will finish its activation first, right child will finish its activation second, and then root node or the parent node will finish its activation. So that is indicated by using pre-order traversal. Then the sequence of return correspond to the post-order traversal of the activation tree. Control stack. So as we have seen that stack, we are using stack is nothing but it is a data structure and it is a dynamic in nature. For what purpose we are using a stack? So stack we are using for holding the activation record of active procedure. So whenever procedure starts its activation, the procedure becomes active procedure, its activation record is created, and that activation record is pushed onto the stack. Okay. If suppose from the current active procedure, if some other procedure starts its activation, so immediately its activation record is created and that is pushed onto the stack. So control stack represents what? Activation of the procedure, where the activation starts and where activation finishes. So that is shown in the control stack. The procedure call and return are usually managed by runtime stack and called a control stack. So when procedure finishes its activation, it has to come back to the point where it stopped its where it starts its activation, so that next procedure or further program can be executed. So that is nothing but return of the procedure. So return of the procedure is be, or the address of return address is taken from the stack only. The flow of control in program correspond to a depth first traversal of activation tree that starts at the root node. Okay, so root node will be pushed first onto the stack, visit a node before its children, so that node should be visited first, then and recursively visit children's at each node and left to right order. So just now we have seen in the activation tree, main procedure will be starting its activation first, so main will be pushed, its activation record will be created, it is pushed on to the stack. From main, some other procedure starts its activation, okay, its activation record is created, it is pushed on to the stack, okay. And if that procedure has left child and right child, so first of all, left child will finish its activation first, and then right child will finish its activation, and then parent node will finish its activation. A stack can be used to keep track of live procedure activation. So just now we discussed that an activation record is pushed onto the control stack as the activation start. That activation record is popped when that activation ends, means when the procedure finishes its activation record is popped from the stack. Activation record. So activation record is nothing but the information about current active procedure. Okay, whenever procedure is in active state, its activation record is created, and its information is given by using that activation record. So information needed by single execution of a procedure is managed by using contiguous block of storage called as activation record. Each live activation has an activation record called as a frame on the control stack. So every active procedure has an activation record. So whenever procedure becomes active, its activation record is created, which is nothing but the block of memory which stores different information about the current active procedure. An activation record is allocated when a procedure is entered, and it is deallocated when that procedure is exited, means it is created when procedure becomes active, and once the procedure finishes its activation, then its activation record is deallocated. And size of each element is determined at the time of compilation. Now we'll see that activation record so that you will understand. Now this is the activation record. Okay, this is nothing but the block of memory which is the representation of the current active procedure. So what it contains? Return value.
Now suppose the current procedure is in active. So what kind of information is stored about that active procedure onto the activation record? So return value. The procedure may return some value, okay? The function, whatever the value the function is returning, that return value stored in the first field, that is return value, okay? The return value of the called procedure is written in this field to the calling procedure. In practice, we may use a machine register for the return value. So we may use the machine register to hold that return value, okay? Actual parameter. So actual parameter, so whenever function, whenever we call a function or whenever a procedure is called, at that time we pass some parameters. So those parameters are nothing but the actual parameters. So these parameters are stored into this field actual parameter. The field for actual parameter is used by using by the calling procedure to supply parameters to the called procedure. Okay, so calling procedure has some parameter which is passed to the procedure which is to be called. Then optional control link. So this is, this field is optional and this will hold the activation record of the caller procedure. Optional access link. So this is again optional field which is used to refer the non-local data of another activation record. So in another active, in the activation record of another procedure, some non-local data may be there. So that data is referred by using this access link field. Then saved machine status. So whenever the procedure starts its execution, the current status is stored onto the activation record, or current status is managed by using the register, and whenever the procedure finishes its execution, that register is taken so that the further execution can be taken place. So the field for saved machine status hold the information about the state of the machine before the procedure is called. So before the procedure starts its execution, the current status is stored into the register so that when process finishes its execution, that status is taken from the register so that further execution can be possible. Local data. So in the procedure, we may use some variables, we may use some local data. So that local data is stored into this local data field. Temporary, we may use some temporary variables, like the way we use some temporary variables in the three address codes. So likewise, we may use some temporary variables in the register, in the procedure. So those temporary variables are stored into this field. Now this is the example which we have taken for the activation tree. Okay, so how that activation of the procedure is managed by using the control stack is shown in this diagram. So initially main program will start its activation. So main is activated and it is pushed onto the stack. So this square indicates the stack. Okay, then after that, from main, get procedure starts its activation. So second figure B indicates get is activated. Get is nothing but name of the procedure. First, main is started its activation. In main, get starts its activation. Third figure C, from get procedure, add procedure starts its activation, and its parameters, its local variables, local data is pushed onto the stack along with the procedure. So add, first main, then get, and then add. After add, we have stored integer C, that is nothing but the variable C, which is a local data of add procedure add, and that is stored along with that procedure onto the stack. Then at the end D, when procedure add finishes its activation, procedure sub becomes active and its activation record is pushed onto the stack along with its local variables or local data. Parameter passing method. So there are four ways of parameter passing: call by value, call by reference, call by copy restore, and call by name. Let us see each in detail. Before we can see these types of parameter passing methods, we should know the basic terminologies R value and L value. So R value is nothing but the value of expression. So value of expression is represented by using R value. So value of expression is represented by using the R value. Suppose A is equal to B plus C. This is one of the expression. So right hand side of the assignment is nothing but the R value of expression A. Okay. The value contained in a single variable also becomes R value if it appears on the right side of the assignment operator. Okay. So assignment right hand side of the assignment operator indicates the R value. L value indicates what the memory location where that R value is stored or where that expression is to be stored. So that is nothing but the L value. Okay, the location of memory where the expression is stored is known as the L value of the expression, and it always appears on the left side of the assignment operator. Okay, so right side of the assignment operator indicates the R value, left side of the assignment operator indicates the L value. Okay, example we have taken A is equal to 1, B is equal to 2 into A, C is equal to 7 plus B. Now here A, B, C, these are the memory locations, variables, that is nothing but the memory locations where the right hand side value is stored. So A, B, C, these are L values, and right hand side of the expression, right hand side of the assignment operator, that is the R value. Okay, then second example, 7 is equal to x plus y. Now this is L value error because right value R value is correct, x plus y is the value of expression, but where we are storing that, we have to store that to some memory location. L value is nothing but what, left hand side of the assignment operator, and it is usually a memory location, but 7 is not a memory location, so this is L value error. Then formal parameter, actual parameter, we know these terminologies. Formal parameters means what? When at the time of function definition, the parameter which we are passing to the function, those parameters are nothing but the formal parameters. Variable that takes the information passed by the caller procedure are called formal parameters. These variables are declared in the definition of the called function. Okay, and these formal variables, formal parameters, takes the value from actual parameters at the time of function call. Whatever the parameters are passed, those parameters are called as actual parameters. Okay, and these formal parameter takes the value from actual parameters. Actual parameters, variables whose values and functions are passed to the called function, are called as actual parameters. These variables are specified in the function call as argument. So at the time of function call, we have to pass the actual parameter. At the time of function definition, we have to pass the formal parameters. Now first is a call by value. Now what is call by value? In call by value, the actual value of calling procedure or R value of the calling procedure is passed to the called procedure. Okay, and that value is also placed into the activation record of called procedure. Okay, now here the important thing is that the formal parameter does not change the value of actual parameter. That is the important point. Let us take example, you will understand it. Here we have taken the example, void call is one procedure and void main is another procedure. So main procedure will start its execution first. Int A is equal to 10. Okay, we have initialized the variable A to 10, and then we have called the procedure whose name is also call. Okay, the procedure is called by passing the actual parameter A. So call A indicates that the main is a calling procedure, call is a called procedure. So keep in mind, the procedure which is calling the procedure, the procedure which is calling another procedure, that procedure is a calling procedure, and the procedure which is called, that is a called procedure. So here main is a calling procedure and call is a called procedure. So the call procedure is called by passing the actual parameter A, that is R value of actual parameter. What is the R value of A? That is 10. So 10 value is passed to the procedure call. That value is stored to the formal parameter X. Okay, the control is transferred to the definition of the call. Here we have passed one parameter int X, so value of X will be 10 here. Then in the call procedure, X is equal to X plus 10 indicates that value of X is a 10, so 10 plus 10, value of X will be 20.
but that value 20 will not be affected to value of A. Okay, so that is the important point. So in call by value, formal parameter does not affect the value of actual parameter. Now here output you can see that value of x is equal to 20, but value of A will be 10 as it is. So formal parameter x does not affect the actual parameter A. Second type is a call by reference. Now here it is important, here in call by value we are passing the R value of actual parameter, but here in call by reference we are passing the L value of the actual parameter. L value means what? We are passing the actual memory location of the actual parameter. So whenever the memory location is passed, it means that whatever value we have stored to that memory location of actual parameter is directly get affected by formal parameter. Okay, so in call by reference, the formal and actual parameter refers to the same memory location. The L value of actual parameter is copied to the activation record of called function. That is what just I have said, the L value in call by reference, R value is passed, keep in mind, but in case of call by reference, L value of actual parameter, that is the actual memory location, is passed. Thus the called function has the address of actual parameter. If the actual parameter does not have L value, then it is evaluated in a new temporary location and the address of the location is passed. Any changes made in the formal parameter is reflected in the actual parameter. That is very important. In call by reference, whatever changes formal parameter is making, that changes are directly affected on actual parameter as the address of actual parameter is passed. In case of call by value, we are passing the right, that is expression, we are passing the value of actual parameter, not the address of actual parameter in case of call by value. But in case of call by reference, we are passing the address of actual parameter. So whatever changes are made by formal parameter will directly affected to the value of actual parameter. One example we have taken here, void call R, that is the called procedure, main procedure. So from main procedure, B is equal to 10, value of B will be 10. Now this call R function will be called call R, but here B is passed along with its address. Not if I pass only B, it indicates the value of B will be passed. Here I have passed ampersand B, indicates that address of B will be passed to the called procedure call R. So at address of procedure B, that value will be stored. Now here call R int star y, that is the pointer variable. So this star y will directly point to the memory location of B. Okay, and whatever changes, that is star y is equal to star y plus 10, that is these changes are made to the memory location of B. Directly that memory location of B, that is actual parameter, is referred, and the changes the formal parameter y is making is directly affected on the actual parameter. Now here output will be value of y will be 10. Now that value is directly reflected to the value of B because its address is passed. So after call R function execution, value of B is equal to 10. That is the output. Third type is the copy restore. It is also called as copy in, copy out, and it is very much similar to the call by reference. Okay, it is the special case of call by reference where provided reference is unique to the caller. Then what is difference? The difference between call by reference and copy restore is that in call by reference, any changes made to the formal parameters are immediately shown, whereas in case of copy restore, any changes made to the actual parameter, formal parameters, are shown only when the function is terminated. Okay, let us take example. Here we have two procedures. Unsafe is one procedure, main is another procedure. So execution will start from main. So main variable A is equal to 1. A is a global variable which is we have declared at the beginning. Then the procedure unsafe is called with the value A. Then unsafe procedure will be called and the formal parameter X will take the value of A. Okay, X is equal to 2, A is still 1. Value of A will be still 1. then a is equal to 0. Now a is value of a is a 0. When the unsafe function will be terminated, after termination of unsafe function, the value of formal parameter is copied to the value of actual parameter. That is, value of x will be stored to the value of a. Okay, so what is the value of a? If I print the value of a in main function, the value of a will be 2. Why it is so? Because when the procedure unsafe will be terminated, the value of formal parameter x is stored into the actual parameter a. This is the copy restore. Then last type is a call by name. Okay, it is less popular method. In this, procedure is treated like a macro. We know macro, how the macro will be expanded. Whenever procedure call occurs, that procedure call is replaced by the procedure definition. That is how the macro is executed. Like the inline function, we know the working of inline function in C language or C++ language, where whenever the function, inline function is called, that function call is replaced by the function definition. So here that function is treated like a macro and it is a less popular method. It is also referred as lazy evaluation because evaluation is done on parameters only when needed. Then last point from this chapter is a symbol table generation. Now we have seen the symbol table, working of symbol table, when the symbol table is created in the first chapter itself, in the first chapter of the compiler. So symbol table is one of the data structure which is created at the time of lexical analysis itself. Lexical analysis means it is the first phase of the compilation. So during that lexical analysis itself, the symbol table is created and which stores the information about various symbols occurs in the program. The symbols may be names, all the names like function name, variable name, object, classes, interfaces. So information about all these entities is stored into the symbol table. Okay, and that symbol table is referred by both the phases, that is analysis phase as well as the synthesis phase of the compiler. The purpose served by the symbol table is as follows. The names of all the entities are stored in a structured format at one place. Names means what? It may be function name, variable name, class name, object name. So all those names, so those such information is stored in one data structure in structured format. The variable is checked whether it is declared or not. So whenever the variable found in the program for the first time, it is recorded into the symbol table. If the same variable is found second time at different place, then it is checked into the symbol table whether that already there in the symbol table or not. So that occurrence is checked by the compiler. The assignment and expressions in the source code are checked for the implementation. The scope of name is determined. Okay. These are the purposes, or this is the basic purpose of the symbol table. Symbol table, so what names can be there? So just now I have told you that names can be parameter name, variable name, constant name, it may be record name, record field, procedure name, array, files, variables, labels. All these are what the names of a program, names used in the program, names used in the program. Okay, a linear or hash table is known as a symbol table. Okay, so this is how the symbol table is defined. An entry for each name is maintained in the following format. So what kind of information is maintained into the symbol table, or in what format that information is maintained into the symbol table? So symbol name, then type of that symbol and attribute. Now attribute, what attribute? It provides the additional information about the symbol. Okay, for example, static int interest. Okay, here int is the type of symbol, int is the type of the interest. Interest is nothing but the name of symbol whose type is int. That static provides the information about what type of integer symbol is this. So static. Okay, so this static is nothing but the attribute. Then it should be stored into the
symbol table as interest, that is symbol name, then type is integer and attribute is a static. The entries related to name are contained in the attribute clause. Symbol table attribute. Now, what kind of attributes can be there into the symbol table? So, each piece of information associated with name is called as attribute. So, that is the additional information which is provided by the attribute about that particular symbol. Attributes are language dependent. It depends on language, what language you are using, maybe C language, different language, C++. So, attribute information changes language by language. Different classes of symbols have different attributes. So, for variables and constant, what type of attribute values can be there? So, type of variable or constant, line number where that variable or constant is declared, it is also one of the attribute value. Line where referenced, okay, scope, these are what attributes of variables and constant. In case of procedure or function, what can be the attribute value? So, number of parameters, then parameter themselves, return value of the procedure. So, these are what attributes of the function. In case of array, that is hash of dimension, means whether it is a one dimensional array, two dimensional array, array bounds. So, this is the attribute information in case of array. Implementation, how that symbol table is implemented. Okay, so symbol table is implemented by using three techniques, we can say three techniques, or by three ways. Linear list, you can call it as a linked list. Second is binary search tree or hash table. Okay, amongst all, that hash table is popular method, okay, and it is mostly used technique, hash table, where key value pair is used, where the source code symbol itself is treated as a key. Okay, so name of the symbol itself is nothing but a key of the table, hash table. Okay, and whatever type of that symbol is there, that is nothing but the value of that symbol. Linked list representation, we have seen three ways are there implementation of symbol table. First way is a linked list or a linear list. So, a linear list of record is the easiest way to implement the symbol table. It is the easiest way to implement the symbol table. The new names are added to the symbol table in the order they arrive. Okay, so in symbol table, how the symbols are stored, how the names are stored, the way they occurs in the program, or the way the names are found in the program, in the same way these are recorded into the symbol table. Whenever a new name is to be added to the symbol table, first it is searched linearly or sequentially to check if or the name is already present in the symbol table or not, and if not, it is added accordingly. Means what? The symbol is found first into the program. Let us say variable A is found in the program first time. So, compiler checks whether that A is already there into the symbol table or not. If it is already there into the symbol table, then that variable A is not recorded into the symbol table as it is already there. But if it is not already there into the symbol table, then only it will be recorded into the symbol table. And its time complexity is O(n), big O(n). Advantages are what? It requires less space and additions are simple. Disadvantage is what? Higher access time. Second way to implement the symbol table is a search tree. Okay, in this, it is an efficient approach for symbol table generation. We add two links left and right in each record in the search tree. So, left tree as well as right tree is added in while implementing the symbol table in search tree. Whenever a name is to be added first, the name is searched in the tree. If suppose just the example we take for the binary tree, suppose the variable A or name A is found in the program. So, it is checked whether it is already there into the symbol table. If not, then only it is added into the symbol table. And every node has two parts, left tree, right tree. Left tree indicates what? Type of that name. Right tree indicates the name of that particular name. Means for example A, A is a name. So left tree will be, if it is integer, int, right tree will be A, int A. Like that, every name has left and right tree. If it does not exist, then a record for new name is created. That is what we have said. This has alphabetically accessibility. Means what? The variables are recorded into the symbol table alphabetical order, not like the linked list. In the linked list, the as and when the records are found, those records or those names are recorded into the symbol table. But here, the names are recorded into the symbol table as per the alphabetical order. Binary tree. So lookup complexity is, if free balanced, if tree is balanced, then big O n. And lookup complexity, if tree unbalanced, big O. Hash table. So it is the most popular method. Table of k pointers number from 0 to k minus 1 that points to the symbol table and record within the symbol table. So here key value pair is used. Basically what we want to say here is a key value pair is used. That key itself is nothing but the name of that particular variable or name of that particular record. That is nothing but the key, and whatever the value it has, okay, that value is nothing but the value of that particular record. To enter a name into the symbol table, we found out the hash value of the name by applying a suitable hash function. To check whether it is already there into the symbol table, we have to apply the suitable hash function to detect whether it is already there into the symbol table or not. The hash function maps the name into integer between 0 and k minus 1. These are the different keys, and using this value as an index in the hash table. Operation, what operations can be performed? Insert, that is, if I want to insert a particular name into the symbol table, what operation I have to do? Insert operation. For example, int A. Now variable A I need to insert into the symbol table. So I have to go for insert operation, that is insert A whose type is integer into the symbol table. Lookup. If I want to check whether this symbol is already there into the symbol table, in that case I have to go for lookup operation. So lookup and symbol. So okay, in this case lookup, symbol is A. So this will check whether A is there into the symbol table or not. Symbol table data structure. Issues to consider are what operations we have to perform. So just now we have discussed insert operation and lookup operation to check whether it is already there or not. Okay, insertion is done only once. Okay, symbol, that is symbol, whatever symbol is found, that symbol is inserted only once into the symbol table. Lookup is done many times. That symbol can be searched many times in the execution, but insertion will be only once. Need fast lookup. The data structure should be designed to allow the compiler to find the record for each name quickly to store or retrieve the data. Okay. So this is how the chapter number 5, we have covered all the points of chapter number 5. For any query, you can write your comment. Okay. Thank you.